All right, learning goals. Students will be able to understand how to use the second derivative. So we're going to talk about the second derivative test, but we're also going to talk about just how we could use the second derivative to make a sketch of a function. So a couple things here. We have some descriptions here. We have if the second derivative is greater than zero, so if the second derivative is positive, this is another way of thinking about this, then we can tell we're going to have a minimum. Because if the second derivative is zero, that means that we are changing in a positive direction. And that's what's exactly what you see here, changing in a positive direction. And so that means we have a minimum. And it's at least a relative min. Could be an absolute. The only way to know that for certain is you got to know a little bit more about the function or the graph. Okay, and the same way, if it's negative, if the second derivative is negative, that means it's changing in a negative direction, so that means that you have a relative max. And then the other thing that could happen is you could have a second derivative that's actually equal to zero, and this is what we call a point of inflection. And so what do we mean by point of inflection? It's kind of important, and this is actually going to be when we have a change in, and we're going to use the word concavity. So, oops, my handwriting got a little messy there. That's a T. So what does that mean? So if you notice here, we have this concavity. This thing is opening upward, and here it's opening downward. So a point of inflection is when we go from like maybe a cupping or a concave upwards to some cupping or a concave where it's open downwards. So that's what a point of inflection is, when the concavity changes. All right, let's go to the next page. Okay, so we got some basic information here at the top, and then we're going to go down here, and we're going to do this pre-example. Now, this is the same as before. This is just finding the critical numbers, but now we're going to find critical numbers twice. So remember, we find critical numbers by taking the derivative, and the derivative here is 6 minus 2x, and we set it equal to 0. And then we're just going to solve for x. Well, if we set that equal to 0, we can add 2x to both sides. We get 6 equals 2x, divide everything by 2, divide by 2. And you get that x equals 3. So we have a critical number there. Now, I'm going to take the second derivative here just to show you what happens. If we took the second derivative, I mean, that's the derivative of the derivative, what would we get? Well, the derivative of 6 is 0, and the derivative of negative 2x is just negative 2. So the second derivative is negative 2. Okay, so what does that mean? That means that this thing is always going to be always negative. The second derivative is always negative. And so in this situation, we're going to have this situation here. It's going to always be concave down, which means this thing's going to look something like that. And that makes sense because we know what this function is. This is a parabola, and it's a negative parabola, so we know that it opens down. So the second derivative is giving us some information we already know because, you probably learned that in algebra class or in math 1 or math 2 class. But now we can actually prove it using the second derivative. Okay, we got our critical number. Let's go on to the next page. Okay, we're going to make ourselves a table using our critical number. So here's how it's going to look. We know we got our x values, and the only critical number we have here is 3. So we really are just going to look at 3, and we're going to look at some x values before 3 and all the way to negative infinity, and we're going to look at some x values after 3 and all the way to positive infinity. And we're going to look at f of x, f prime of x, and f double prime of x. Okay, and we already know that when x is 3, the first derivative is 0. And we learned that the second derivative is always negative 2, so we could just say, hey, this is always negative. And we could say that that's all we can really fill out for now. So let's go back to our function and see how else we might be able to fill this thing out. Looks like we want to know something before 3 and something after 3 in terms of the derivative, so we can tell how this was changing here and how it was changing here. And basically, because we know that the second derivative is negative, we already know that this thing is kind of cupping downwards. So we actually can make a prediction. I predict that it's actually going to be positive here because it's going up. So this is going to be positive because it's going to go up. And then it's going to be negative here and it's going to go down. But let's actually use calculus to verify that. So before 3, what's a good number to plug in? Well, I think 0 is probably a really good number to plug in. And 4 is probably an easy number to plug in that comes after 3. And so let's write the derivative again. The derivative, of course, is 6 minus 2x. And so let's do y prime of 0. That's 6 minus 2 times 0. Hey, and what do you know? 6 minus 0 is 6. And sure enough, that is positive. And what about at 4? Well, this would be 6 minus 2 times 4. 2 times 4 is 8. 6 minus 8 is negative 2. Hey, what do you know? That's negative, just like we had said from our second derivative test. Okay, so it looks like if we were to make a sketch of this thing, and this is where it gets real fun. So we could actually make a little quick sketch. And now we're not going to just draw straight lines, because we know this thing is not only is it going up, but it's concave down. It's got this curve to it that is open downwards. So we could actually sketch it as something like that. We know that this is, since at this point of 3, it's still negative. So we know that it's going to be a max. It's important to write here. We know we're going to have a max there. And it's just going to flatten off because the derivative is 0 there. And then here, we know that it's going down. It's going to go down, and it's still cupping downwards. So we can kind of make a sketch like so. And we get a lot of information from there. So since we know we have a max, we could actually plug 3 into our original function to figure out what that max is. So let's do that. So y of 3 would equal 6 times 3 minus 3 squared. And that's simply 18 minus 9. So that's 9. All right. So we got a lot of information here. We've made this little simple table. We got a lot of info. Let's see if we can answer some of these questions. What can we say about F? Well, we know that it is. I'm going to zoom in so it's easier for me to write here. It is concaved down, which kind of means that means it's opening downwards. So it has a max at x equals 3, which is 9. So that's just telling me the max occurs when x equals 3 and the max itself is 9. Okay, what can we say about f prime or the first derivative? Well, we know that it has a 0 at x equals 3. And is always decreasing. Now, what do I mean by that? I mean the first derivative is always decreasing because the second derivative tells us so, right? Remember, each derivative tells us something about the slope of the previous one. And the second derivative is always negative. Therefore, the first derivative is always decreasing. Kind of interesting. And then what can we say about the second derivative? Well, we know that it is always negative 2. We learned that from the pre-example. And so it's always negative is really the important part. Not so much that it's negative 2, but that it's always negative. Okay, that was a relatively simple one. Let's do one that's a little bit more fun. Let's go to the next page. Okay, we got a lot more going on here. And this guys, is very similar to some free response type questions where they're going to ask you to analyze functions. So this is going to get pretty interesting here. Let's do our pre-example work and let's find our derivative and therefore find our critical numbers. So the first derivative, do that one in blue, is going to equal negative 15 x to the 4th plus 15x squared. And remember, we want to set this equal to 0 and solve. Now, this is actually not that hard to solve if you think about it, because you can just factor. There's a lot of things we could factor out. The first thing I see is, you know what? I could just divide everything by a negative 15. If you think about it, you can do that. And over here, your 15s would cancel out, your negative 15s would cancel out, and this would become just negative 1. So you really end up with x to the 4th plus, I should have just said minus x squared, equals 0. Now, remember, these are not equivalent equations, but they're going to have equivalent solutions, and so that's important to understand. That's kind of the beauty of when you have an equation set equal to 0. Okay, so can we factor this? Well, yeah, we could take out an x squared, right? If we take out an x squared, we'd have x squared minus 1 equals 0. And actually, we could factor this because this here is a difference of squares. So we could actually say that this is x squared times x plus 1 and x minus 1 equals 0. So now we should have three solutions here. 0, if I plug a 0 in here, the whole thing will be 0, negative 1, and 1. So our three solutions, or our three critical numbers that we got, are 0, negative 1, and 1. Okay, but remember, we actually can get critical numbers from the second derivative as well. So I'm going to do that part in red. So the second derivative, what would that be? Well, let's kind of look up here, ignore the crossing out that I did. I got a 4 times negative 15. That is going to be negative 60x cubed. And the 2 times positive 15, so that's going to be plus 30x. Still equals 0, so we can see if there's any more critical numbers to be discovered. And we could definitely factor out a 30 here, or divide both sides by, and let's go ahead and divide by a negative 30, just make our lives easier. Okay, so if we do that, we would get a 2x cubed minus x equals 0. We could factor out an x, of course, giving us x times 2x squared minus 1 equals 0. And so this tells us that we are going to have a critical number at x equals 0 again. But we already have that, right? We know that we're going to have another critical number at x equals 0. And actually, when you have a critical number from the first and the second derivative, usually that's going to be something kind of unique is happening in that situation then. So probably we could look and see something unique is probably going to happen at 0. But we still have this guy, 2x squared minus 1. And this is a little bit weird to think about, but we could solve this. We could just use our zero product property. And we get 2x squared minus 1 equals 0, so therefore 2x squared equals 1. Then divide by 2, you get x squared equals 1 half. Square root, so we're going to end up with x equals plus or minus, don't forget your plus or minus, 1 over square root 2. Now, you could rationalize that, it'd be rad 2 over 2. Doesn't really matter, think of it however you want. But that's another two critical numbers. And that's important because we're going to put all of this into a chart and we need to have all of our critical numbers. And so we got 0 showing up twice, we got negative 1 and 1, and we got square root 2 over 2. Now, it's a good idea to know approximately what that is, so we know where to put that in our table. And if you don't know what that is, it's approximately plus or minus 0.7. Okay, so we know that comes before 1. All right, let's go ahead and go to our table now that we've got all this critical number information. Told you this is going to get real fun. Okay. So we have our x values, and we have a lot of those, right? We know that there's something important happens at negative 1, and then the next thing is actually going to be at negative square root 2 over 2, and then the next thing is at 0, and then positive square root 2 over 2, and then positive 1. Okay, let's try and fill this in as much as possible. Because we want to know what happens in between these things as well. So it's getting real interesting, right? And we want to know what happens afterwards as well. Okay, so Remember, this is just like saying, hey, between these values, and this is like saying, hey, between these values. And these last ones are going all the way to positive infinity, and this is going to negative infinity. Sorry, I'm running out of space there. Okay, let's start filling some stuff in. We know we're probably gonna evaluate the actual function at some points. We're gonna evaluate the first derivative at some points. We're gonna evaluate the second derivative at some points. And in fact, we already have, right? We know that there are zeros from our second derivative at plus and minus square root 2 over 2 and at 0. And there are zeros from our first derivative at negative 1, 0, and positive 1. Okay. So now we're going to have to fill in some of this information. And remember, it's only going to change signs. It's only going to change signs in here when things are 0. So I don't really have to evaluate all three of these here. I could just use one of these values. That's any value that's less than negative square root 2 to plug in for this whole domain here or this whole domain here. So let's start over here. We need to plug in a value into the first derivative. Now, I would highly recommend at this point that you use a calculator. So I'm going to use the y equals function of my calculator, and I'm probably going to put this function in y1. I'm going to put the first derivative in y2. And I'm going to put the third derivative in y3. So I would go ahead and do that real quick. 1, 2, 3. Plug in all those functions so that you can use the table feature to fill this thing in really quickly. So maybe pause the video and go ahead and do that. Okay, so hopefully you got those in your y equals. Again, we're talking about the original functions that we got for the derivative and the second derivative. So negative 15x to the fourth. Plus 15x squared and negative 60x cubed plus 30x before you factored out the 30 or the 15. And let's start just plugging some values in. I'm going to use my table. I need some value that's less than negative 1. Use whatever you want. Let's just maybe just negative 2 over here, just positive 2. So negative 2, when I plug a negative 2 in, I get a negative here. And I actually get a positive there. And so this is interesting because I don't have to fill out the information anymore. I actually know these are all going to be positive because it can't change signs. It can't change signs without first hitting zero. So these are always going to be positive here. All right, so what do I need to plug in next? I need to plug in something in here. So I could just plug in. Actually, I think I'd probably get the most information if I plugged in something here. Remember that this is approximately negative 0.7. So you could just plug in like a negative 1/2. So let's do that. Negative 1/2. When I plug in a negative 1/2, I get a positive. So that means these are all positive. And I get a negative for my second derivative. So this is negative. Okay. And then I got my 0. And so just like I plugged in a negative 1/2 here, I could plug in maybe a positive 1/2. Remember, I'm just plugging in test values that are in between here. So if I plug in a positive 1/2, I actually get a positive and a positive. And remember, that means that these are all positive. And then I need something after here to plug in, but 2 is a good number to plug in. So I'm going to plug in 2 for both of these. And I get a negative for both of these, which means that this is all negative 2 because it has to touch 0 to change signs. Okay. Pretty interesting. I got a lot of information here. So what I want to do with this before I do anything else now is I want to kind of do a basic sketch. So let's think through what all this information means. I know there's a lot on here. By the way, on calculus, on the AP exam, you make a table like this on a question where they ask you to analyze a function like this, they're going to just eat this stuff up. They're going to love this, okay? So let's do a sketch here. And let's just think about this one stage at a time. The derivative is negative, so we know it's going down, but the second derivative is positive, so we know it's cupped upwards. So we could actually say it's going to look something like that. Here, the first derivative is 0, so we know that it flattens out, and the second derivative is positive. That actually tells us something about what it's going to look like. It's going to turn into like a little, I like to put little arrows here showing which way we're going. So this is actually going to be a min according to our second derivative test, right? When the second derivative is positive, that means that we're going to have a minimum there. Okay? And it's not just the second derivative positive. It also means that the first derivative is zero because we don't have a min here, right? We're here, but at this location we do. Okay, this one is going up because the first derivative is positive and it's cupping up, so it's going to look something like this. Now this is interesting. It's going up still, but there is no defined concavity. Well, we're going from a positive concavity to a negative concavity, so this actually tells me that we're going to have something that looks kind of like this right here. And so this is going to be a point of inflection because we're changing concavity. Okay, and then we are still going up, so we're going up, but now it's caved down, which makes sense because we went from an upward cave to a downward cave. So it's going to look something like this. And now we have this double zero here, and so kind of think about this. Remember, the zero on the first derivative means that it's getting flat, but it did go from increasing to increasing, so it's going to do something like this. It's going to go up, flatten out, and then go up again. So we can see that it's going to do something like that. That's also a point of inflection. Here we have positive positive. We already know what positive positive look like. It means that it's going up and caving up. So this is going to look something like this. And then it's still increasing, but we have a zero in the second derivative. Means it's we're going to probably have some point of inflection, and sure we do, because the concavity changes. So actually, it's the same situation as here, if you notice. One plus to minus with a plus on top, plus to minus with a plus on top. So looks just like that. And I'm running out of room to make these kind of good sketches here. So that's another point of inflection. And then what do we have here? Going up, but caved down. We had that situation here. So it's going to look like this. And then we have it flatten out. And we know that the second derivative is negative at that point, so that tells us that this has to be a max. And then finally, after 1 and onto infinity, it's going downwards and cupping downwards, so it looks like this. Okay, I know, there's a lot going on there, but we just got a really, really good idea of what this function is going to look like, how it's going to behave, what intervals it's going to behave on, and all that kind of stuff. So we know quite a bit about this. I know that the table thing is a little bit overwhelming, but remember, all I did here is find my critical numbers. I'm just going to circle all those, right? These are all just critical numbers that I got from the first and second derivative. I laid them out in order, of course, obviously in order, going from negative infinity to positive infinity, with intervals in between, so we can see how things are changing. And then we're just using our calculator to fill in the data. Now, I use the calculator because I can, and there's no reason not to. This could be a non-calculator question, and it's not that bad because you can just plug in simple values here like -1 or 1/2 or -1/2 or +2, and you can plug those values in to fill your chart in. So it may be a little bit time consuming, but these are not really difficult problems to evaluate. Remember, you don't even care about actual numbers. You just care about their sign. Are they positive, negative, or zero? And you should already have the zeros already done. That should be the first step. Okay. Also, just because it hit zero doesn't mean that it's going to change signs. Notice here the first derivative went from positive to zero and then back to positive again. So it doesn't always change signs. So it's kind of important to be able to analyze that. And I did say we'd have something unique going on here, and we do. We have something, a weird type of point of inflection here where it keeps going upwards, but the concavity changes. So, okay, let's answer some of these questions. What can we say about f? Well, we could say a lot, right? We know it has points of inflection at x equals plus and minus rad 2 over 2, so both of those places, and at 0, right? We know it has at least a relative min at x equals -1, right? And a relative max at x equals positive 1, right? So these are all things that we learned from our sketch. Right, there was my relative min, there was my relative max. Pretty interesting. Okay, what can we say about the first derivative? Well, we know when it's increasing and decreasing, right? We know that it's decreasing on two different intervals. If you look up at the top, right, there's two different intervals where it's decreasing. It's decreasing from negative infinity to negative 1. And then it starts decreasing again at 1 all the way to positive infinity. And we know that it's increasing. Well, it's increasing pretty much the entire time from negative 1 all the way to positive 1. So we know quite a bit about that. And we also could say something similar about the second derivative. We know when it's increasing and decreasing. So it's decreasing. Well, it looks like it's decreasing from negative red 2 over 2 to 0. And from positive red 2 over 2 to positive infinity. And I should have put a C there for increasing. And it's increasing from negative infinity to negative red 2 over 2. Sorry, my handwriting's getting a little sloppy here. And then, again, it's increasing from 0 just to positive red 2 over 2. Okay, well, we got a lot of information there. Now, I know that last problem was a little bit intense, a little bit longer video than usual, but I want to show you this one because this is definitely the type of question you see on a free response. So, all right, see you guys on the next video.